This figure shows the principle of aquifer thermal energy storage. The left part of the figure shows the summer situation where cold groundwater is pumped out of an aquifer to the left. The cold water is used for cooling a building using its air conditioning system via a heat exchanger. Note that water that has warmed up during the heat exchange process is returned to the aquifer. In winter, the operation is reversed. The right part of this figure shows the warm water, which infiltrated during the summer, now being pumped out. The warm water is used for heating the building using its central heating system via a heat exchanger. Note that the water that has cooled during the heat exchange process is again returned to the aquifer, now for later use in summer, and so on. Groundwater holds its temperature quite well. The thermal conductivity of aquifers is low, and groundwater flow is slow, as we have calculated earlier, causing aquifer thermal energy storage to be an effective technique for both the cooling and heating of buildings, replacing part of the electricity demand in doing so, and thus also reducing possible burning of fossil fuels and CO2 emissions into the atmosphere. At Utrecht University, we have an aquifer thermal energy storage project in use. The saturated hydraulic conductivity K, as used in Darcy's law, strongly depends on the groundwater's temperature. Therefore, calculations of the volume flux Q and the effective velocity of groundwater in aquifers used for thermal energy storage should always take this into account. The hydraulic conductivity K is a function of both properties of the porous medium through which the water flows and properties of the water itself, such as density and viscosity. The properties of the porous medium and groundwater can be separated by combining the Hagen-Poiseuille law and Darcy's law through a cylindrical tube. This gives this equation. K is the saturated hydraulic conductivity in meter per day. Kappa is the intrinsic permeability in square meter. Rho is the water density in kilogram per cubic meter. Mu is the dynamic viscosity in kilogram per meter and second. And g is the acceleration due to gravity, 9.81 meter per square second. 86,400 simply is a factor to directly convert the hydraulic conductivity from meter per second to meter per day. The intrinsic permeability kappa in square meter is a function of the size of the openings through which the groundwater flows and thus of the porous medium. Both the water density rho and dynamic viscosity mu, being the thickness or resistance of a liquid to flow, are properties of the groundwater that are temperature dependent. Water density is largest at 4 degrees Celsius, and viscosity decreases with increasing temperature. A hydrologist is interested in the movement of water, whilst a petroleum engineer is equally interested in the movement of carbon liquids and gases in the subsurface. Both these fields of expertise deal with porous subsurface media, and tribute has been paid to Henri Darcy by using the Darcy as the unit of intrinsic permeability, with 1 Darcy being 9.87 times 10 to the power minus 13 square meter. Let's imagine that we have an aquifer with an intrinsic permeability kappa of 16 Darcy. In the Netherlands, almost all aquifer thermal energy storage projects operate at a relatively small temperature range between 5 and 25 degrees Celsius. K given the water densities, rho, and dynamic viscosities, mu, at injection temperatures of 5 and 25 degrees Celsius, we can estimate the saturated hydraulic conductivities at these temperatures to differ a factor of 1.7, as shown in the outcomes here.